With the worldwide turmoil in both the stock and the currency markets, the Mexican stock market has plunged to levels not seen since 1995. But the impact here on the border is not as severe as it could be. If America is the land of opportunity, Mexico is the land of deals. Good deals for American shoppers who for years have flocked to Nuevo Progreso.
How much did you spend here today?
Oh, probably $300-$400.
You're going to find a lot more bargains over here than what you'll do in the States.
The peso has lost about 27% of its value over the past year, including a 5% drop Monday alone. That may be bad news most places, but not everywhere.
Devaluaciones.
Along the border, devaluation is good. Francisco Polito says his store, the El Disco, is one of Progreso's most popular. Americans spend a lot of money here, and a week in peso spells opportunity.
I think you get more for your money, that's for sure.
In the long run, a devalued peso certainly cannot be good for the Mexican economy, but what we have found, at least here in the border town of Progreso, is that a devalued peso is good in the short term. What it does is bring more American tourists across the bridge to shop over here in these local stores. They in turn bring local American dollars, and that makes these merchants very happy.
It's good or bad?
It's good.
Same story in the restaurants and cantinas. La Fogata caters to an upscale American clientele, and the dollars flow freely here.
We here in the restaurant, for us, is very good because the dollar is high.
And so too is the confidence in President Zedillo and his policies.
Nuestro presidente de la República.
We have confidence in the president and the country. Francisco Polito says we expect him to give us a good sign. An even better sign will come in just a few months when the annual migration of winter Texans makes their influx to the valley. It is the anticipation of their dollars that brings a smile to the merchants' faces, even as the rest of the country stares down the barrel of an economic disaster. Back to you.
On a related note,
the headlines in the Corpus Christi paper read, "Killer escapes death row," but this is not the first time that Martin Gurule has tried to bust out of a jail cell. It was during Gurule's trial in 1993, while inside of a Corpus Christi holding cell, that he smashed this door open and busted a one-inch deadbolt lock.
This whole thing was bent out, so hit it for a while.
It gave authorities a glimpse into the violence Gurule was capable of, as his former girlfriend told me in 1993.
Martin did what Martin wanted to do. I didn't question him.
Were you scared for your life?
Yes, I was.
Smith used to work the cash register at the restaurant where Gurule robbed and murdered two of the employees in 1992. A year later, she was sentenced to 25 years in prison. Gurule to the death chamber. Last Friday, he and six other Texas death row inmates stuffed dummies in their beds before heading for the exercise yard. Outside, they cut through a fence, hid on a roof for several hours, and then made a run for it. When guards opened fire, the other surrendered. Gurule didn't. Today, the man who helped put him on death row is extremely concerned.
He's not only good at what he does, but he is very evil. He's a dangerous person.
Evil and yet smart and cunning at the same time. Authorities here in Corpus Christi tell us the man who walked into this popular Bayfront restaurant and executed the owner could indeed be on his way either to the valley or into Mexico in order to very quietly fit in. His daring escape is raising some tough questions. Did Gurule get help planning his escape? From who? Inmates? Guards? How could prisoners remain undetected on the roof for so long? And perhaps most important, why aren't death row inmates monitored more carefully?
How in the world can somebody do this? You know, I figured that they'd be watching these people 24 hours a day. Apparently not.
As the mother of victim Tony Staton reflects at her son's graveside, she hopes for a fiery end to this story.
I don't mean this cruelly, and I don't mean this to be revengeful, but in my own heart, I hope when they catch him, I hope he puts up a fight and they kill.
Now, Martin Gurule could be anywhere in Texas at this hour. Here at one of the valley's many international border crossings, it seems to be at least a likely choice. And that is why these mugshot profiles of Martin Gurule will soon be making their way down here so that people in the valley know what the people in Corpus Christi already know.
All right, Dave, thank you very much. And authorities along Valley Borders are ready for the fugitive as they...
...body when there's some kind of sexual motive involved in general.
They never had a chance, did they?
No, in this particular case, they really didn't.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dave Johnson, reporting tonight from San Antonio, Texas. The death of Selena Quintanilla last Friday shocked the entire state of Texas, shocked many in the nation. But the real problems behind the shooting began 160 miles to the north, here in San Antonio, at Selena's boutique on Broadway Street. It was this boutique which opened back in October, and a boutique that Yolanda Saldivar began operating. Saldivar had proven herself so helpful in running Selena's fan club, she was hired to manage Selena's store in Corpus Christi and in San Antonio. Published reports say she had a key to the home Selena shared with her husband, Chris, control over Selena's business checking accounts, and increasingly, hostility over anyone who tried to question her authority. There are 5,000 tulips being flown in from Holland. Here is just another massive display of flowers just in the San Antonio area. And we're not even talking about any of the other cities in or around this area. Authorities say Yolanda Saldivar was one of Selena's closest friends. But unfortunately, according to the authorities, she had a fondness for money. It was a money problem that apparently led to their breakup. Published reports say she had a fondness for rental cars and cellular phones. She also reportedly spent a whole lot of money on buying new clothes just before a trip to Mexico. Saldivar quit her job as a registered nurse to become Selena's road mom. But money would apparently ruin the relationship between the pair. On Wednesday, Selena was forced to fire Yolanda Saldivar over financial discrepancies. The next day, Saldivar reportedly phoned Selena and arranged for a meeting at the Days Inn on Navigation and Interstate 37. Jimmy Gonzalez, who was with Selena's production studio in Corpus Christi, says there was no fight when Saldivar was fired. She just said, okay. Selena then reportedly proceeded to the motel, went to room 158, and was shot once in the shoulder. Selena died shortly afterwards. Saldivar barricaded herself inside of a red pickup truck for a 9.5-hour standoff before giving up. She's under a suicide watch at the Nueces County Jail. In San Antonio, hundreds of fans are paying their last respects. From kids.
Good evening. Tonight from the Harris County Courthouse, Dave Johnson reporting. 6 days of testimony and 33 witnesses later, the prosecution is about to wrap up their case against Yolanda Saldivar. Medical testimony took up much of the morning and the afternoon, but perhaps some of the most critical testimony has come within the past hour from an ID technician by the name of Ed McKinstry. He testified that the 38 caliber revolver taken from the truck of Yolanda Saldivar cannot, and I quote here, cannot be fired accidentally. On the surface, that appears to contradict Douglas Tinker's theory of an accidental shooting. Joining us now is Corpus Christi attorney Jorge Rondell, who is a trial analyst up here. Former state district judge. Judge, what does all this mean?
Well, that's very significant because the state has effectively put on some evidence that contradicts the defense's theory. The defense is saying that this gun went off accidentally, and the experts are saying today that the gun cannot go off accidentally. In effect, that somebody has to pull the trigger.
The other testimony came from the doctor who was treating Selena in the room, a doctor by the name of Lewis Elkins at Memorial Medical Center, who basically said Selena was brain dead when she was first brought in, and there were massive attempts to save her life, all of which proved unsuccessful. Again, Judge, we usually don't hear testimony in murder trials about attending physicians and all this. What is the significance of this testimony?
I believe the significance is that there had been some question as to whether or not there had been instruction from the family not to give Selena any blood transfusion for religious reasons. And the doctor testified that transfusions continued while she was there, and that he didn't know about any such request, and if he had heard about it, he would not have honored it anyway because he was trying to save her life.